Hello, this is Kong Yan from Shanghai Academy of Social Science. My paper is about the social network of Caodong tradition in Song China. And this paper is written in Chinese. For better communication, I will present my ideas in English and show the evidences in Chinese as the workload of translation is really large. So as we all know, Morton Schutter has done very excellent studies on Caodong tradition in Song Dynasty, which gave me a lot of inspiration. I tried to promote the research to some extent. And plenty of studies on Chan focused on the destruction of lineage. However, it is not a feature of Chan Buddhism. It is not even a unique cultural tradition of Buddhism. I think maybe it's time to divert our attention to how the Sangha actually operate and the function of the lineage in their social identity and the actual operation of the imagined community. And so for the masters, the lineage is a necessary social identity, and it is an imitation of patriarchal clan, and it's a performance of Confucianization of Chan Buddhism, according to great folk and John Jonathan's study. And previous study on Chan most focused on reinvention of lineage. It seems that the sacred identity determines the development of the sect. As we know, there are different records of lineage of Caodong tradition in Song Dynasty, in Song Bao Zhuan and Chuan Deng Lu, which Morton Schutter made a detailed study of. However, the Chan masters did not try to construct a more perfect explanation, and the records did not cause widespread debate in Chan Buddhism. Why? It seems that the lineage is necessary for them, but it's not overwhelmingly important. So what is the significance of Dharma transmission, transmission to sects under the background of proliferation of public monasteries? The abbots should be chosen according to virtue instead of family relationship. In the circumstances, how did the transmission family operate in reality to realize the inheritance and expansion of the sect? And Morton Schutter pointed out the competition for the mindset support for literati gives rise to quite unprecedented sectarianism in Southern Song that culminated with Da Hui's attacks on silent illumination. But here's a contradiction between sectarianism and public monasteries. So as the abbot is selected according to its virtue, but how does sectarian awareness keeps growing in public monasteries? How does the abbot trans their abbacy to their own disciples? So this whole pattern relies, according to my previous study, the operation mode of Dharma lineage in public monasteries is a variant pattern of torture family in hereditary monasteries. The mode of inheritance has been changed from torture disciple to Dharma heir. The ceremony of Shilin has been changed to Kaitang, and the place of development has been changed from specific hereditary monasteries to public monasteries all over the country, which is more inclusive and open. But on the whole, its organizational model is still clan. This clan organizational model still continues a certain relationship of rights and obligations, and can still play the functions of recommending each other on supporting each other and sharing social sources and networks. Although most of the Taodong masters who held an abbacy were at public monasteries, it is still possible to make their family members to succeed to their abbots. However, this pattern did not function as stable or independent as Tartar families. The sect retained its heritage with the help of local government officials who were very important figures in the social network of Taodong Sangha. So let's take several temples as an example. The Chongsheng Baoshou Chan Yuan in Mount Dahong, we can see that when it becomes a public monastery, from the first generation to the seventh generation, including the 11th, the abbots comes from Taodong sect. And the Jingying Chanyuan in Dongjing, we can see that the Lumen Zijue is a disciple of from Daokai and they are all the abbots. And Yuan Tong Chongsheng Chanyuan, Wei Zhao is the Dharma uncle of Hongzhi Zhenjue. And Zhenjue succeeded the abbacy from Wei Zhao. And including the Chenglu Chongfu Chanyuan in Zhenzhou, we can see that five Taodong family members were the abbots. And so is the Sizhou Da Sheng Pu Zhao Chan Si. And Wen An Sizong is the disciple of Hongzhi Zhenjue. And Yi Zhong Zhong Zifu Si, Wen An Sizong is abbot and then is his disciple Zong Jing. And Xue Feng Chong Shou Chan Si, we know that Hui Zhao Qing Yu is a Dharma brother of Zheng Xie Qing Liao, and he succeeded Qing Liao's abbot abbacy after he retired from Mount Xuefeng. And so is the Tiantong Si and Xuedou Si, especially Xuedou Si, we can see that five abbots come from Taodong sect. And we can see how does it happen. And it relies on local government officials. So compared to pure lineage scheme, the social network seems to play a more active role in the revival of Taodong tradition in Song Dynasty to conduct a reasonable review of their social network. Chan literature or Buddhist literature is far more enough. We need to follow the clues mentioned in Chan literature and Buddhist literature and do great number of researches of historical documents of those government officials and local elites, which have closer connection to the contemporary literature, politics, economics, cultural customs, military conflict, and so on. Besides, those educated elites are also connected by genealogical, geopolitical, and official some relations, which makes the network more complex. And then I will present my paper in Chinese. 接下来我们就看一下具体的这个社会网络是怎样的。其一呢，就是源于宗派对于宗族对于宗派的支持。我们可以看到，就是说香州韩氏家族和真定韩氏家族，从这个芙蓉道凯到大红报恩，一直到他们的弟子，这个丹霞子纯啊，他们一直是我们始终能够看到这个韩氏家族的身影。那么接下来呢，是开封府的李氏家族。那么这个李氏家族是主要是兄弟俩李孝寿和李孝琛，让他们不仅帮忙奏请子衣，帮助道凯去免除刑罚，而且还提拔他的 这个法寺鹿门法灯去继任他那个静音禅院的这个住持之位啊。我们可以看到他俩这个从1105年到1113年，多次就是一直是他们俩在担任这个开封的这个府尹。然后第二方面呢，我们看一下宗室对宗派的支持。那么首先就是关于就是这个外戚高士泽，我们可以看到高士泽的祖父是这个立下赫赫战功的这个军官啊。然后这个他的这个先这、就是他的先祖，然后他的这个先祖的孙子呢，高宗甫呢是宋英宗高皇父的父亲。高皇后的父亲，而这个高士泽本人的这个祖父啊，不好意思，这边写错了，他本人的祖父高士林呢，就是宋哲宗轩辕胜烈皇后的弟弟。那么可以看到这是名副其实的皇亲国戚啊，而且呢，他本人是深得宋徽宗和宋高宗的信任的。那么宋徽宗呢，也是命他去执掌军权的。而宋高宗呢，在南渡的时候，更是把他作为自己的贴身侍卫。在身边，睡觉的时候都是不分开的。那么后来呢，这边临安这边稍微稳定一些呢，他就给了他一个这个做温州太守的兼职了。然后我们可以看到他在做这个太守温州这个守臣的期间，也恰好是清了当时被这个大会宗搞批判嘛，从雪峰寺退居，后来就这个到临安又到。这个温州龙翔兴庆寺，那么在温州龙翔兴庆寺的这个期间呢，刚好也是这个高士泽做这个守臣的这个时间，我们可以看到，当时他过来的时候是中书省门下省尚书省同奉圣医差僧清了住持，那么我们也会相信，就是说有可能这中间是高士泽去奏请的，那么关于这个如果。这个为什么会这样一种猜测呢？是因为这个清了跟宋高宗有一种非常神奇的关系啊，因为我们看到从这个《建炎系年要录》里面，我们看到宋高宗说温州啊有一个僧人清了，跟他的徒弟说呢，我曾经赏赐给他诗，但是呢，我真的是不认识他啊，怎么会有赐诗这种事情呢？说温州这个。官方要好好的查究一下，不要到处传播，好像我比较好佛道一样。其实我对这个佛道呀，不曾留意啊，这个对于治国没有帮助啊，特意去强调这个事情，这是非常有趣的。但是我们可以看一下，这个从绍兴七年开始呢，就是有这个朝廷的诏命啊，要召清了去住持，被他赐了。而就在他声称他不认识清了的这一年呢。朝廷还批准了清了申请赐官田的札子，还有又批准了这个申请免差借人船等费用的札子。那么此外呢，清了完成龙翔兴庆寺的基础建设之后，把这个图绘了一个图上交给朝廷，还获了1500次良田。然后，这个如果你不认识他，你这个怎么可能呢？尤其是像。这个绍兴15年又召他住持径山寺，径山寺也是大庙了。那么到这个，1151年，宋高宗为他自己的亲生母亲慈宁太后建这个崇仙显孝禅院祈福啊，又专门召清了前往住持，而他的母亲也专门去听清了说法。所以你说你不认识他，这个是不太可能的。那么他问到他为什么要强调这一点呢？那么这个跟当时的政治风气是有关系的，因为当时呢，这个和已经成为这个南宋的国事的时候，朝廷想办法去避免战争，争取和议，但是仍然是有很多的士大夫是反对和议，坚持抗战的。那么如果这个时候传出高宗好佛的说法呢，所有人都会把他去和议的这个政策视为这个佛教、道教这个避世倾向的这样一个影响。然后，并且他可以用这个儒家正统论来批判，这个说他被异端学说迷惑，所以这个时候秦桧又更特别强调高宗不惑于异端，执帝王之学，来将合议的政策与高宗本人的这个宗教倾向呢划清界限。这是个小插曲啊。那么第三部分的支持呢，主要是来自于地方的守臣对于宗派的支持。那么大洪山是曹洞宗的根据地，从这个洞下第8世芙蓉道 芙蓉道开大红报恩开始到第十世庆县，到这个大红山变为十方丛林，几乎都是曹洞宗禅师去相继住持的。那么这样的局面其实是离不开随州地方守城的支持。我们可以看一下啊，这个第几代是在变成十方丛林之后啊，我们看到有外台啦、守城啦，好像有一些看起来不像是守城的官职，我们接下来会细说啊。那么这一些我们刚刚看到的这些守城很多都是当路主司者，主要就是有帅、曹、县、仓四个机构里面出来的。那么这些主要就是有一些军管型的行政组织啊，我们大概可以把它理解为就是说都是一些地方的这个路的长官，而且这个路的长官往往是这个不是一般的这个长官，因为宋代只有京朝官暂设郡政，而无地方官治理郡事，它的目的在于收地方的政权归朝廷，所以我们不能仅仅把这些看作是地方长官，他们也往往都是京朝的关外祭，与中央保持着密切的关系。我们可以看一下这个就是随州其他寺院的一些例子，也都是奉太守之命。那么第二，我们可以看一下这个淮南东路和两浙东路的地方守官，那么这些都是曹洞的禅师他们住持的寺院以及他们请住的人物，基本上都是太守啊。我可以看一下太守有一些是皇亲国戚了，郡王啊，然后有一些是包括像皇子啊，那么但是他们之所以能够有这个去奏请这个事情，其实我们仔细去翻阅一下文献会发现，其实跟他们当太守都是有关系的。像代制这个职格，包括这个郡王他们其实都是做过这个地方路的，刚才我们提到的这几个长官的四个部门长官，所以我们可以做一些推演，我们可以总结一下，看看好像说看起来好像是皇亲国戚和朝廷重器啊，但是他们与曹洞禅师们相较的因缘，主要是因为在地方任守城或者地缘的关系，而不仅仅是因为他们是皇亲国戚。因为这些地方守城，我们可以看出他们还都是主管军政的，这个也可以从中看出这个两宋之际权力的走向。那么在这个宋代我们还可以看到他们与地方守城的关系，有时候未必单纯是一个地方长官与辖区内僧侣的关系因为有时候就像我们举法公的例子，因为他是弘治政局的法司，他是姓林，他的从姑就嫁给了娄月的叔祖，所以他跟娄月是从小一块玩到大的，所以后来娄月可能成为他的这个护法，有这个血缘家族方面的世间这个宗族方面的关系。那么另外呢，就是比如说以这个张孝祥为例，那么张孝祥看待宗爵像父亲一样，是因为这个张孝祥的父亲张琦，包括他的这个叔叔，他伯父，叔叔张绍之，都是跟这个宗爵关系非常好的，所以他从小是跟着父兄一起去见这个宗爵，自然而然就把他当做父亲看待一样。那么其实我们可以总结一下他们这个曹洞宗社交网络的几个特点。那么第一呢，就是宋代曹洞宗禅师虽然是与帝王将相有一些来往那么他的发展其实都是依靠这些地方守城、地方精英还有地方的宗室成员和外戚交往更多一些。第二呢，就是他们的社会网络是在法院宗族内部是被继承和共享的。第三呢，就是对于士大夫来说，他们与曹洞宗禅师的这些亲密的来往关系也是可以在家族内部传承的。第四呢，就是士大夫尽管被列为某宗某师的弟子，但是他们的交往和知识的范围并不具有鲜明的排他性，他们有可能是同时去护持多个禅师甚至不限于一宗一派那么这个是曹洞宗社会网络的几个特点。 那么这也是本文所要跟大家探讨和分享的。就到这里，好的，感谢大家。